YouTube.
Doesn't matter.
There is in the waiting room Majority's Fire TV Stick. You might know this guy. Anyone?
Tell him to take his stick out the fire.
Nope.
Majority's Fire TV Stick. Okay, no. I'll allow him in. Maybe he's one of ours and couldn't change the title or name. And if
I can do introduce himself, no?
Yes, I will. I will. I will admit first because he's in the waiting room. He doesn't. He may not be reading my messages. So let's give me a few seconds to ask the guy who is. What kind of majority he's talking about? Let me see. Hello, Majority's Fire TV Stick. Could you identify yourself, please? You seem not having camera or the microphone, so I don't understand how that works in Zoom meeting.
Marjorie. Not
hey, David, good evening.
Marjorie.
Good evening.
Oh, that's trouble.
Did I see just... There he is. How are you, Jeff?
Hey, Jeff. Good to see you.
Likewise, sir. Is our guest
David,
of honor...
David, we got Jeff.
Venkat?
Hi, Shri.
Very worshipful brother, Venkat. So nice to see you.
Thank you.
Good evening, brother Shri. Good evening, brother Venkat.
Good evening.
Lavenka, let's give a few more minutes because there are a lot of people coming in. So let's give them two more minutes and we start at 8:05. But I still don't get the response from Majority's Fire TV Stick.
David, it's Marjorie, as in a lady's name.
Oh, okay, Marjorie. Oh, Majority. Sorry. Okay.
Are the elections coming up, David, in Georgia?
Yes.
There you go.
That's what I see, right? okay, understood. Okay. I thought it was Majority. kind of, it just jumps around all the time when people add in and kind of, I just read it like that. Okay, so I think now it's quite calm out there in the waiting room. So more people coming. All right, so first of all, let me mute everyone. So we don't have any microphones on. As always, welcome to Sapere Aude the lecture. This is the next one. It is being recorded. It is streamed live through YouTube. It is the honor of the Grand Lodge of Georgia to host today very interesting topic delivered by our brother Venkandram, and it's about a very interesting anecdote, as he has put, from the annals of the Freemasonry, told about the Amir of Afghanistan's joining the craft. So just to let you know that we will be talking about the history of Afghanistan, of this person who lived and ruled the place between 1872 to 1919, and we'll have one aspect of his life, which was why he joined Freemasonry. He insisted actually to join it, to the surprise, as I read, of Englishmen back then. And we will have Brother Venk to tell us more about this story. I just want, as always, remind everyone that while participating, while presenting opinions, while a lecturer who is the main guest of these lectures, we all present the individual opinions of ourselves. We don't represent the institutions here. That's to be emphasized, so it is correctly understood. Not only today, but every single lecture that has been out there, it was an opinion of an individual brother, an author, Masonic author like Bob or Andreas or David and Joseph and all the others. They all represented their own private opinions, and that is very important important issue to be always have in mind when we discuss or react on the opinions or ask the questions or take any citing from these lectures to prove or disprove something in another discussion. It is always an opinion of an individual brother, Mason or non-Mason, who expresses it here. So just I want to thank so much today's lecturer for sharing his time with us, preparing this interesting lecture. And he's a lodge secretary in the Lodge Silver Dawn 7000, and it's district of Bombay in India, and he's past grand sword bearer and the UGLE. So having said that, it is my pleasure to mute again. Someone's mic is still on, I guess, and give floor to esteemed lecturer. Please unmute yourself and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Brother David. Thank you very much. It is indeed an honor to be here for two reasons. One is, of course, first time I'm talking to an international audience, but I've noticed that in the chat room, there are three brothers from Lodge Concordia, and the current secretary of the lodge is also here. And this entire story is around that lodge, and that lodge is the central figure of where this incident happened. And I'm extremely happy to see that they are also here to hear the story. No doubt it has often been heard and told and retold many times, but what I want to make clear is that I am not the author of this story. The author is somebody else. I am only retelling the story, and everybody who tells it with his own flair and style and puts his own elements into the story. So here is my way of telling the same story. Okay, I have tried to stick to the original. So in the presentation that I make, the paper has been written by McMahon, and his paper is in blue, the original paper, and then whatever I have added is not in blue. Okay, so off we go. Okay, so the title of the talk is "The Amir of Afghanistan Joins the Craft." The Amir is the ruler, and Afghanistan is, of course, you know, everybody now knows where Afghanistan is, and you know, there's a very curious case, an extremely curious case of, you know, how he decides to join the craft. And this is a story that must be told many, many times over, not because it's curious, but because it brings out the importance of masonry in so many aspects that we don't realize often, and how it also shaped world history at a very critical juncture of time around the World War I. Okay, so you know, certain schooling systems are not very strong on geography, so I thought, let me put a map to show to an international audience where which is the part we are talking of. I am assuming that the pointer is here. So this is Georgia, and we are now in the, you know, we are being hosted by the District of Georgia between the Black Sea and the Caspian Sea, just to give an element of, you know, space. This is Afghanistan, of course. This map is from 1914, if I'm not mistaken, and it shows undivided India. So Pakistan didn't exist at that point of time. We were still United India. This is the place from where the Amir of Afghanistan entered into India, a place called Landli Kotal. This is Bombay, the district of Bombay from where I am speaking. This is Calcutta, where Lodge Concordia was warranted and established in 1905. And Ceylon is here for two reasons. One is my friend Jacques from Sri Lanka is here on the as part of the audience. And a little bit part of the story is, you know, concerns how Ceylon played a role in this entire event. Okay, so this is a geographic, just to put a visual image to what is happening and, you know, in which part of the world all this happened. So this is in blue, which is the original paper. Okay, and there are many versions of this paper available. I am sticking to the original version. There are many people who have gone and added more stuff and this. So the entry of H.M. Habibullah Khan, Amir of Afghanistan, into Freemasonry by Lieutenant Colonel Sir A. Henry McMahon. The following article appeared in September 79 Proceedings of the United Masters Lodge, New Zealand. Its introduction advises that the author who wrote the paper. So this paper was written in 1936, and this entire event happened in 1907. So just to give a sense of perspective, 1907, 2020, 113 years back. So we are a century and 13 years back, and this is a story from that era. It is written by McMahon, who was then the chief commissioner of Baluchistan. Chief commissioner is somebody who controls the entire armed forces and, you know, the government. And you're the chief commissioner of Baluchistan. Baluchistan is a province that is on the west of India, now in Pakistan, and borders Afghanistan. Okay, so that is where it is. When and where the original paper was presented is not mentioned. Okay, we don't know when it was. Okay, so who was Habibullah Khan? What was his background? And why did he want to probably become a Mason? That's you know, dealt with a little bit later. Habibullah Khan was the Emir of Afghanistan from 1901 till 1919. The World War I was 1914 to 1918, which is within his life period. And in 1907, he wanted to become a Freemason. So this entire event is in 1907, when he was probably 35 years of age. Okay, yeah, 28 plus 30. So about 35 years of age, that is when he became a Freemason in 1907. He was the eldest son of Emir Abdul Raham Khan, who was succeeded by a right of progenitor in October 1901. Habibullah was a relatively, I have underlined, okay, reform-minded ruler who attempted to modernize his country. During his reign, he worked to bring modern medicine and other technology in Africa to Afghanistan, In 1903, Habibullah founded the Habibia School of Military, as well as a military academy. He worked to put in place progressive reforms. He instituted various legal reforms. So So basically, he was a liberal, forward-looking kind of person, just the kind of person that a Freemason is often known as. Somebody who's liberal, somebody who's, you know, reform-minded, somebody who wants medicine, wants to bring, you know, legal reforms, progressive reforms, reform-minded. You can see the word being repeated again and again. This is a picture of the Amir of Afghanistan. This is from the cover page of a newspaper called The Sphere. And it's in January something. And it shows the photo of him. And it says India's new royal visitor. So this is the photo. This is what the man looks like. Okay. Again, to put a visual element to the story. The story is written, the entire proceedings. Arthur Henry McMahon was the person who accompanied him, took him around, and made him a Mason. Okay. So he has written the paper. He was very well decorated officer, British Indian Army officer, served as the High Commissioner of Egypt from 1915 to 1917, administrator in the British Raj, served twice as the Chief Commissioner of Baluchistan from 1907 to 1911. 1907 is when this happened. He was known for his McMahon Hussein correspondence with Hussein bin Ali. So this correspondence is a set of about 13 letters, I believe, and out of which one is supposed to be very important. Hussein bin Ali was the caretaker of Mecca, which is the, you know, holiest of holies for the Muslims. And he was the caretaker. He was like the, say, the Pope in Vatican. And this correspondence has happened between McMahon and Hussein bin Ali, where he's being assured that, you know, if they don't allow the Russians to come in and if they don't allow the Ottoman Empire to come in, the British will take care of Mecca and Saudi Arabia and remain permanent allies with Saudi Arabia. So this is the kind of correspondence that went there. McMahon also drew the McMahon line between Tibet and India, and we are seeing some, you know, battles there. We'll cover that a little bit. And then he wrote the declaration to the seven in response to the memorandum by the seven notable Syrians, very, very assured the Syrians that that the rule of the natives will be assured. That is, the rule of the subject will be an important aspect of the way in which Britain will control to rule Middle East. Okay. He's also featured prominently in Seven Pillars of Wisdom, T. Lawrence Arabia, this. So basically, this gentleman claims his legacy goes back to the Irish clans of the 12th century. There is a continuous descendant. His father was serving in India. He was born in India. He knew English, of course, but he also knew Persian, Urdu, and Arabic, okay, and Hindi, okay. So he was well versed in the languages. So you can see that almost his entire career has been in the Middle East. He has managed Middle East for the British during the period of the World War I, a little bit before that, and a little bit after that, okay. So basically, that is the background of this gentleman who writes this story. This is a picture of him. Again, very slim, sharp-featured, well-decorated. And, you know, just to give a visual representation of who is the author of this paper. A little bit interesting, because China and India are now, you know, on the border dispute. This line demarcates the line between Tibet and India at what is known as Arunachal Pradesh. So this is not where the skirmishes are happening now, but it is a line that has been signed between Tibet and India. And him representing India, representing British India, about 550 miles from Bhutan. So it's in the eastern part of the country. We'll take a quick look at the map here. And you can see that this is a McMahon line in Arunachal Pradesh. China still disputes this border. Tibet has accepted this border. But right now, the skirmishes are happening somewhere here. They are happening somewhere here. But this is the map of India, current map of India with whatever India has got in its positions. So basically, the gentleman negotiated treaties. He settled disputes. He went into agreements with on behalf of British India with various ruling powers. He was a very, very high level officer, you know, somebody very, very high in the hierarchy of the British Empire. So this is back in blue, which is his words. Okay. It has been suggested to me that an account of the circumstances in which His Majesty Habibullah Khan, Amir of Afghanistan, became a Freemason would be of value, as it would record an interesting and important event. The facts briefly are as follows. The British government in 1906 invited the Amir of Afghanistan to visit India, and on his acceptance of the invitation, I was placed in charge of all the matters connected. So he was his complete host, coming into India, going out of India. He arrived at the Indian frontier at Landi Katol. Landi Katol is a place, we'll just see a few photographs of that small picturesque place. On January 2nd, 1907, I think January 1st, he must have wanted to celebrate in a proper fashion before calling this guy in. So it was on January 2nd, 1907. And the Amir was accompanied by a numerous retinue, which included escorts of infantry and cavalry. So, you know, you can imagine horses, you know, probably camels, probably horses, and then, you know, foot soldiers. I don't know how they traveled. There were no railway lines at that point of time, but that is how the Amir traveled, and that is how he entered India. He was 34 years of age, had never set foot outside his own country, man of strong and determined character, very superior intellect, and surprisingly well informed in all general subjects. So what is Landi Kotal, the place where he goes and receives him? He's one of the largest towns in formerly federally administered tribal areas. It is located at a height. There's a place called Khyber Pass, and Landi Kotal is like kind of the town that you kind of controls Khyber Pass. And Khyber Pass is part of the original Silk Route, who are, you know, interested in that part of the history, that controls Central Asia from India, you know, Pakistan and India. Okay. So it marks the entrance into the province of Afghanistan, which is located 5 kilometers to the west. It's a tourist destination. It has got a small safari train, stuff like that. This is a picture from about 1936, I think. And this is a fort of Landi Kotal. And this fort is overlooking the Khyber Pass. I'm assuming that this road coming from the plains is the pass between the two mountains. And this fort is, you know, overlooking the pass. This is probably an encampment. It doesn't look like a regular town because they're all tents. But this is a photo of Landi Kotal in 1936 with this fort. Okay. This is how it was. So in 1907, it must have been even more rudimentary. Probably even these tents were not there. It was just open barren land. This is a photo of Landi Kotal about 2 years back. It is now a small city, bustling city in Pakistan. Looks like it could be any small city in Pakistan or in India. And it has got cars and, you know, you can see all the stuff there. So this is what Landi Kotal is today. Okay. The author continues. A few days after his arrival, he astonished me by expressing a wish to become a Freemason. So astonished, okay, me to become a Freemason. But not knowing his motives, I gave him no encouragement. So see how important this is. You know, today many lodges rush to make people, you know, anybody who comes in as Masons because they want numbers to increase. But this gentleman, not knowing his motives, did not give him any encouragement. Okay. He returned to the subject on several occasions. So Amir was persistent. He wanted to become a Mason. He touched the topic on several occasions, but it was not until January 22nd. So again, timeline, January 2nd, 1907 was when he was received. After 20 days, January 22nd, that I realized how very much he was in earnest. The underlying is underlining, the emphasis is mine. Okay. In earnest. He begged that if it could be done, it should be without the knowledge of any of his staff and people. So again, you know, Freemasonry was not very well looked upon in Islamic countries. He was very earnest and he said it should be done secretly. Okay, so the king of Afghanistan wanted to become a Freemason, but in secrecy of his own subjects. It may be asked why the Amir should want to be a Freemason and how he came to know anything about Masonry at all. Remember, this gentleman has not stepped outside his country. Okay, he has not been abroad. He has been born. This is the first time he is stepping out of his country. From Afghanistan, he is coming to India. He is leaving his country for the first time. It may be asked why the Amir should not be a Freemason and how he came to know anything about it. All I could ever get the Amir to admit was that he had met good men who were Masons. Underlining his mind, Okay. So, you know, a favorable opinion preconceived of the institution. Okay. So whatever ritual pieces I quote will be from the emulation ritual, which is what we practice under the United Grand Lodge of England. So in a preconceived opinion favorable of the institution, which I am favorable opinion preconceived of the institution, sorry, which I'm sure, you know, is there in one way or the other in most ritual workings. That he knew Freemasonry would be a good thing and he wanted to enter it. Whether he ever entertained an idea of instituting Freemasonry in Afghanistan, I do not know, but I think not. And to the best of my knowledge, there has been no Freemasonry in Afghanistan. At any rate, nothing has ever been heard of his subsequently taking any steps to do. So he came to Freemasonry of his own will and accord and with a favorable opinion preconceived of the institution. This the author understood very well and he made a decision that he is a worthy candidate. Okay. The problem before me was one of extreme difficulty. The only Masonic lodge in India which in any way met the requirements of the case was one in Calcutta, Lodge Concordia, number 3102, of which we have brethren sitting here today. Thank you very much once again. With a small but exclusive membership restricted to British civil and military officers of high standing. Okay. So they were, it was a British lodge. There were only civil and military officers, have very high standing. And we will see some of the officers, we will see who was the, you know, proposer and seconder shortly. We were to arrive in Calcutta in 6 days' time, that is on 28th, and we were to stay there for a week. So on 22nd, he decides, yes, I should make this guy a Mason. He has a good opinion, he has heard about it, he wants to be a Mason, he is a very nice guy, he has got all the qualities to be a Mason. So on 22nd, he makes a decision. They are to arrive in Calcutta on 28th, within 6 days. And they are going to stay in Calcutta for 1 week. So 7 days. Okay. So 7 plus 6, in 13 days, this mission has to be accomplished and in secrecy. If the Amir were to be made a Mason, it could only be done in Calcutta. And whatever Masonic work had to be done must be done at one and the same meeting, because he cannot keep coming back and forth and tell his numerous retinue where he is disappearing. Okay. Apart from the obligations of secrecy, which would be hard enough to ensure that even one visit to the lodge, our crowded schedule of traveling of official and social engagements made it impossible to fit in more than one Masonic meeting. In other words, if the Amir was to be made a Mason, all three degrees were to be given to him at one and the same meeting. And all Masonic regulations about stated periods between proposals, elections, degrees must be waived. So a template dispensation was called for proposing, seconding, balloting, initiation, passing, raising, all to be done in one evening. And only 13 days were available to accomplish this. Okay. So this was the challenge that the author took it upon himself, because he saw that the Amir was a wealthy person fit to be made a Mason. A little bit about Lodge Concordia. This is what Lane's record shows. It was named in 1905. The warrant was issued in 1905. It was issued in March, consecrated in July. It's a Holstone Medal Lodge, 1921 to 1932. And it has been 3102 all the time, because after 1894, there has been no change of numbers. So it has been 3102, Lodge Concordia. It exists even today. And that is a brief history of the lodge. So the author continues. Lord Kitchener was the Commander-in-Chief of the British Army. Okay. So this person is like the, you know, Commander-in-Chief of the, you know, armed forces of the US, you know, if the US is to be an example. Okay. So Lord Kitchener was most fortunately at that moment, the District Grandmaster of Punjab. He was a District Grandmaster. He was a Freemason. He was a District Grandmaster of Punjab. And I at once communicated to him the facts of the case, begging him to telegraph for an all-embracing dispensation to meet the many requirements of the case from the Grand Master. The Grand Master at that time was the Duke of Connaught, who happened to be at that moment on a visit to Ceylon. So that is why I showed Ceylon, because, and remember, this is not the age of emails, this is not the age of WhatsApp. We just have telegrams, okay? Telegram has just come. And another point is that how did these people travel? Because we know that the Amir of Afghanistan came with a numerous retinue. Did that retinue travel with him? Did those camels and horses go all the way from there to Delhi to Calcutta? We don't know. I mean, we don't know. Did they board a train? Were trains there? We don't know. But that is how the entire cavalry traveled. Okay, so the permission was asked from the Grand Master, Duke of Connaught, who was in Shillong, and that he did forthwith. And they got on telegram that said, the emphasis is mine. I approve of the Amir receiving the 3 degrees and give dispensation. Welcome him into the craft in my name, Connaught. Okay, so very terse telegram, giving an all-powering dispensation. Many of us who are secretaries know how our provincial grand secretaries behave. Give me the money, send me a letter. None of that business. Okay, here. With your apologies to all provincial grand secretaries. Okay, so with this great obstacles removed, the rest of my task proved less difficult. For on getting into communication with the Vasul Master of Lodge Concordia, Vasul was the EW Dentit. I found him willing and eager to give all the necessary assistance. So the district grand master agreed, the district grand master of Punjab agreed, the Vasul Master of the Lodge agreed. So everything was, all systems go, as they say. So this is the Duke of Connaught, okay? And this is a picture. Again, very coincidentally, 1907, around the same time that he sent the telegram. And he was the 7th child and 3rd son of Queen Victoria and Prince Albert. So he was from royal blood. He was the district grandmaster of Bombay, the district in which I belong, of which I'm the deputy now. So he was the district grandmaster of, from 1887 to 1901. He was already given the rank of the past grandmaster in 1890. And in 1901, he became the 5th grandmaster, which he held till 1939. 37 times he was re-elected till he, went into the age of 90. So for 37 years, he is the second longest serving grandmaster in the United Netherlands of England. The longest serving for 63 years now, if I may remind, is the Duke of Kent, the current grandmaster. Okay. We go back to the paper. To ensure complete secrecy, he called an emergent meeting of his lodge for February 2nd and personally hand-delivered. So January 7th, Amir comes into India. January 22nd, MacMahon agrees and decides that he must be made a Mason. On January 28th, they come to Calcutta. February 2nd is the meeting. Okay, and personally hand-delivered summons to the members. The secrecy the Amir desired was to protect himself against potential enemies at home. On February 2nd, he was to dine with Lord Kitchener, Commander-in-Chief of India, and as a special compliment to his host, went to his home unaccompanied by his Afghan staff. So that is how he kind of, slipped his team and went secretly to become a Mason. Immediately after dinner, we drove off unobserved to Lodge Concordia's Masonic Hall. This Masonic Hall is in Park Street, exists even today, a beautiful building. In the cyclone recently, there were some pictures that went around about, the building having collapsed, trees having fallen down. Let me assure those who have seen those pictures that the trees fell in the parking area of the hall and not on the building. The building is well protected, okay? Not to worry about it, okay? So going back, this is a copy of the summons that was delivered, hand-delivered. On that day for that meeting, okay? Hand delivered, written in good ink. I will not read the entire thing. Lodge Concordia number 3107, Calcutta. Vasul Master of Dentit, whom we have mentioned, senior warden, junior warden. In attendance at an emergent meeting, February 2nd, 1907, Freemasons Hall, 54 Park Street, even the current address now, 9:30 p.m. Brethren, do note this timing. 9:30 p.m. after dinner, the lodge is going to be tied. Okay. And here, the agenda of the day, if favorably balloted, to initiate, pass, and raise by dispensation, His Majesty Habibullah Khan, Amir of Afghanistan, proposed by Right Worshipful Brother, His Excellency Lord Kitchener. Lord Kitchener is the District Grandmaster of Punjab and he is the Commander-in-Chief of the British Army in India. Seconded by Right Worshipful Brother Sir W. Barkett. So Sir W. Barkett was the Chief Justice of the High Court of Calcutta, High Court of Bengal. Okay. So the Chief Justice of the High Court, the Commander-in-Chief of this, they are the proposer and seconder of the candidate. And the lodge after 9:30, after dinner, has met and all the 3 degrees are going to be worked. You can imagine Everybody is hustling through his small ritual book. Everybody is memorizing various portions. And you know, even if there is one degree working, how much of effort and time it often takes. But here, complete three. And I'm told that none of the elements of the ritual were ever skipped. Okay. So all the three were done completely. When the lodge, the author continues, when the lodge was opened, H.M. Habibullah Khan, Amir of Afghanistan, was proposed as a candidate for initiation by Right Honourable Brother His Excellency Lord Kitchener, District Grandmaster, Punjab, was duly seconded by, of course, Right Honourable Brother Barkit, who was the Chief Justice of the High Court of, you know, Bengal, District Grandmaster, and was duly seconded, approved in ballot. The three degrees were conferred in full form. No shortcuts, no skipping of rituals, full form by the Grand Lodge officers. Okay. Both of them were Grand Lodge officers. An unusual feature of the proceedings was the fact that the candidate expressed his unwillingness to take part in any portion of the ceremony until he clearly understood its nature. He also did not adopt any shortcuts. He wanted it to be completely understood. He said, I must understand what I'm saying and I do not know English. Please translate. Fortunately for us, McMahon was very, he was born in India. He was fluent in Hindi, Persian and Urdu. So he carried out a running interpretation. He acted as a senior deacon, caught his elbows, took him around, perambulation, everything, and carried out a running interpretation in his own language, Persian. Okay. At the conclusion of the ceremony, the worship master resumed the chair. So the worship master stepped aside. The two Grand Lodge officers did the ceremony. They stepped aside, bade Amir a warm welcome into Freemasonry and membership of the lodge. Brother, let me try to put this into context, okay? So sometimes when we read history, we don't understand the current context. Imagine the Secretary of State, that is what Lord Kitchener is, okay? And the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of the USA, that is what Barkit is, you know, something similar to that. They are both initiating the candidate, okay? The candidate has expressed his desire to be a Mason. He has expressed a desire to be secret. And the candidate, just to put it in context, not that, you know, I'm just taking any name, is, let's say, the Ayatollah Khomeini. Okay? Ayatollah Khomeini has come from Iran, wants to be a, you know, Freemason, has heard it. And there's a running commentary in Persia. And all the three degrees are done. Complete secrecy. Nobody in Iran has to know that this guy has gone and become a Freemason. And they make him a Mason. That is the import of that evening. That is the closest parallel that I can draw towards what happens in this paragraph. That is so important how he became a Mason. Okay. Continuing, the proceedings terminated at midnight, started at 9:30, terminated at midnight. I am sure they were very, very efficient in the ritual working. We would have taken up till next year morning when the Amir took his departure and we returned to Lord Kitchener's house. When I, at a later hour, escort him to his house. The copy of the Quran in which he took his obligation is now in the library of the Grand Lodge of England. Okay? So historic, next time you go to Freemason Museum, please ask Susan Snell, who is the current librarian, to show you the Quran. I don't know where it's kept. Hopefully it sits on its own display and we can take a look at this historic Quran. Continuing, it is satisfactory to record that so successful proved the measures taken to ensure secrecy that no knowledge of his Masonic episode ever came to light until after his return to Afghanistan, when for some unknown source, rumors of Amir, you know, you can never keep a secret, rumors of, they were WikiLeaks even in those years, rumors of Amir having become a Freemason began to spread and the fanatical mullahs of that country seized upon them for making the purpose of trouble. You know, these mullahs have always been had a history of that. On his coming to Amir's knowledge, he summoned the leading mullahs to appear at a public assembly in Darbar, informed all present that he was not only a Freemason, but proud of being one, that he had become one to the benefit of his country, and that if ever a mullah were found to criticize his action in this manner, in this matter, he would pay for it with his head. So strong, he owned up. He didn't say, no, I'm not a Freemason. He owned up being a Freemason. He said that he had become a Freemason for the benefit of his country. And you know, he defied all the mullahs. And he said, you know, you'll mind your own religion. What I am doing is my business. We go back to history. Why is this so important? Why did the Amir of Afghanistan become a Mason? We will never know. But by becoming a Freemason and by doing this, it has somehow changed the shape of world history. Let's go back. 1914 to 1918 is the World War I. Okay. Persia and Saudi Arabia are largely under the control of Great Britain. India is, of course, the crown in the jewel, controlled by Great Britain. Afghanistan is here. And the Ottoman Empire is somewhere here in the yellow. Okay. In the yellow. And the Russians have joined and they are continuously trying to make a breach between India and Iran, Iraq, Persia, Saudi Arabia. The Middle East was important for oil. The British ships had started the naval tradition. It was a naval, you know, Britannia ruled the waves, and it ruled the waves because of its ship, the naval strength. Diesel was very important. The ships had just started becoming, you know, motorized with the diesel. You know, good source of diesel oil was important in those years, as it is important now. And it was very necessary to hold the Middle East together. That is why all those correspondences. History records that numerous approaches were made by the Ottoman Empire to veer the Amir of Afghanistan and become part of their coalition. The Amir did not do it. If the Amir had agreed to become part of the Ottoman Empire during the World War I, you know, supporting his fellow Islamic, you know, countries, history records that Britain would have had to pull out all the Indian troops and bring them to Balochistan to, you know, secure the borders. If the Indian troops had been pulled out from their locations, the history of the World War I and what the outcome would have been different. Okay. So the Amir of Afghanistan becoming a Freemason, being loyal to Britain, we don't know why he became a Freemason, but being loyal to Britain was a very key factor in deciding the outcome of World War I in favor of the Allies. What happened to Habibullah afterwards? We come to the end of the story almost. Habibullah was assassinated while on a hunting trip at Kala Ghosh, Lagman province. On February 20, 1919, his assassination was carried out in his sleep by his youngest son, which is unfortunate. And then his brother took over. And after that, the youngest son ousted him. And then the youngest son took power from the Amir. And the Amir met with a death by being assassinated by his own brother. Where is Lodge Concordia today? Besides having the secretary in our midst, Lodge Concordia is very much alive, kicking. It was consecrated in Calcutta. This is the Twitter handle. It moved to London in 1965. And then from there, it found a home in 2012 in the province of Devonshire, Torquay, Devon, small coastal town. And their Twitter handle, which I've highlighted in yellow, says Mother Lodge of the Afghan Mason. So that claim to fame still continues for the lodge. The lodge, I pulled up two photographs. The lodge president, of course, like to play golf. And you know, who doesn't like fraternity? They like to play golf. And they don't forget their Northeastern corner charge, especially when there are, you know, nice ladies around. Okay. So that brings me to the end of the story. Thank you very much, brother.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
An interesting story.
Thank you.
Before we give floor to questions, and you know that you should raise the hand. It is on the right side, who's unfamiliar with the Zoom format or a platform. You should click on the participants and it appears, and there is this button saying raise your hand and we'll go through the order. Before I give the floor to others, my question would be, what do you think, as having read, researched the story, what was the motivation? Did he make any civilizational choice when he decided to join Freemasonry, thus kind of declaring his choice? Was that kind of a signal, kind of a firm signal to then British Empire saying that I'm on your side? Or were there more than political motivation, which is... seems that he has been very knowledgeable, educated person. He made a huge impression on the author. He kind of expressly emphasizes on his astonished impression. So was there, do you think, personal opinion, more than politics, like more than kind of know thyself search out there when he decided? Because it seems like he came, everything was constructed for him. And to some extent, if you take the context of the story, question remains how he continued his growth as a Freemason. Did he participate later on in kind of was he coming? How did he continue his journey as a Freemason? And taking this context, what was the motivation, do you think? Sorry for a long question.
It's very difficult to ascribe the motivation, because that may never have been expressed and that may never have been, you know, wheeled out by MacMahon, because he spent his entire time. But in the paper, from the reading of the paper, it is clear that he had a very good impression of Freemasonry. He probably knew that Freemasons are very well connected. Probably this is all public knowledge by that time, you know, that the Grand Master is the Queen's son and, you know, stuff like that. So he knew that Freemasons were at the highest levels of the hierarchy of the British Empire. And by joining Freemasonry, he would kind of, you know, lend his hand of support or, you know, reach his hand out. And I think, I mean, this is only a surmise. One can never be sure. One can never say this very authoritatively. Unless the Secretary of the Lodge has got more materials with him, because the Secretary himself is here. I would think that he definitely wanted, he was forward looking. He was reform minded. He knew that his religion then as now was not very reformed, and he knew that if he went with the Allies and if he went with the British, then he could take his country to reform, move his country ahead, do good for his citizens, etc. And he knew that he had to be with the Allies to be able to do that, because if he did not, then he would come under the control of his mullahs and his religious leaders would kind of not want progress. And we are seeing even now, after 113 years, where Afghanistan is, okay? So I think that this is again a surmise, okay? I think that he wanted his country to be pulled out of medieval practices or medieval religious practices. And he felt that by coming to India and by becoming a Freemason, he was kind of making a very signal statement that he wanted to be liberal, he wanted to be with the Allies, he wanted his country to be progressive. That's what I can infer from this.
Thank you. So it's more or less political interests and more in
could be. I mean,
good,
yeah,
good connection. We are discussing here the private personal opinions, of
correct,
course.
Correct.
Yeah, so thank you. The floor goes to Brother Sri.
Thank you, Brother David, and thank you for having my Deputy District Grandmaster tonight's show. Brother, very worshipful Brother Venkat, I don't know if you know the answer, and perhaps Simon, who's also on tonight, may, who's of course the Secretary of the Lodge. But I'm just wondering, I'm curious why it was that they decided that the Amir should actually be initiated, past raised in Calcutta, and that too in Concordia, and I'll expand on that a little bit. Because coming over from Afghanistan, one has to cross across the whole of northern India, and quite clearly Lord Kitchener, who was the district grand master of the Punjab, would have been the obvious choice, you know, to have these ceremonies carried out maybe in Delhi, someplace closer to the Afghan border, or perhaps even downwards in Pakistan, in Karachi, which was, as you know, part of the district grand Lodge of Western India, District Grand Lodge of Bombay, rather. But they decided to go all the way across the country, and this is not a small, it's a subcontinent, all the way across to Calcutta and do this there. Point one. And point two, this is not to denigrate Concordia, of course, but I'm, as you know, Brother Venkat, I'm a joining member of Lodge Star in the East, number 67, which is the oldest UGLE lodge outside of the British Isles. And I'm curious why they did not choose number 67, which was and continues to be a very prestigious lodge, but instead chose Concordia. So this dissonance of why travel across the subcontinent and then go and get him initiated, passed, and raised in a lodge which was not the Primus Lodge in the district. I find that quite interesting. I don't know if anyone, if you were perhaps.
From what I can understand, I don't think they went all the way to Calcutta only to get initiated in that lodge. The plan of the entire itinerary must already have been set. And Calcutta was a very key part of the British Empire. I mean, it ruled a very central part, and we know that Calcutta was far greater, port city than what it is now. Okay, so Calcutta was on the itinerary. They were to travel to Calcutta for various reasons. Okay, it was part of the overall plan. Now he was going to be there for 1 week, and within that 1 week, some lodge had to initiate him. Okay, I think sometimes it's just a matter of the district grandmaster talking to the district grandmaster and somebody just picking up. Somebody who's very close and, you're just around and say, hey, can we do this? And then everybody saying, okay. And then not really making a conscious choice. But I think it was more a choice of convenience and, whoever happened first. And then also a certain willingness of the brethren to do all this, etc. Also, in those times, many lodges did not meet regularly also. Because of the British war and many of those lodges being infantry, officers and Bharatipur could probably throw some light. Possibly some lodges didn't have the quorum to meet and make this possible. Even that is another reason it could happen. But I don't think it was a very conscious decision to go to Concordia. I think it would be more a matter of convenience. And Calcutta was anyway part of the plan to travel, go back and come. But I'm very interested. I mean, I would really want to know how they traveled, whether they took a train or whether the animals were parked at Lundi Kotal and they took this, or whether the retinue accompanied him all the way there and back. I have no idea, but yes, I intend to research that aspect of how they actually traveled during that time with that pomp and grandeur.
Dave, yeah, thank you. That's very helpful. Thanks.
Brother Bharat, you want to add something, I guess?
Yeah, Brother Venkat, first of all, congratulations and thank you for that wonderful exposition on this, very interesting part of our history. And I, having served as a regional grandmaster for Eastern India, yes, in the same building, I had the opportunity of raiding the library there many number of times, thanks to the good offices of the district grandmaster of that time, K.P. David, and now his successor, Dave Thapar. So I've done a little bit of study into this curious episode. So I would just like to add a few things. One of them will probably answer Shree's question. Please remember, this was happening in 1907. The capital of British India still was Calcutta. It was not New Delhi. New Delhi came in about 10, 12 years later. So the fact remains that everything important was in Calcutta. So his visit to India was a state visit. He had to be visiting Calcutta for the state visit. It couldn't be a state visit visiting Lundi Kotal or Delhi or any others, quote unquote, provincial places. He had to go to the capital. So there was no question of him not going to Calcutta. So what had to be done in Calcutta. And the other thing you have to remember is the District Grand Lodge of Bengal was the largest district under the UGLE. At one time, it extended from Eden in the west to Singapore in the east. So the District Grand Master of Bengal was the second most important officer in the UGLE system. So it was only natural for a lodge under him to do this honor. It couldn't have been done anywhere else. As far as the selection of Concordia itself is concerned, I was told that was the only lodge which was supposed to have a meeting in Calcutta anyway. But the problem there was that if they wanted to have it as a surreptitious meeting. So therefore, they had to create this emergent meeting for the purpose of that blanket dispensation which they got, in which they did all 3 degrees. The other interesting thing of the evening was there was that, as you said rightly, there was a state dinner for which he had gone unaccompanied by his retinue to the government house in Calcutta. So the carriages brought him in the front. He got off the carriage, got into the government house from the front. They had their dinner and they exited from the back door and went to Freemasons Hall. And they finished what they had to do in Freemasons Hall, came back to government house through the back door, got into the government house, and then exited from the front door and got into his own carriage to come, go back to his place. So that was a beautiful story of the Emir of Afghanistan. And the other point I wanted to make is, one of the questions asked by David is, what was his rationale? Please remember, there's a great game, as it was called, was played between the Tsarist Russia and Imperial Britain, going back 100 plus years, going right from the middle of the early part of the 19th century, going into the 20th century. This was part of the same thing. He was under enormous pressure. If you remember, in 1905, there was a famous Russo-Japanese war in which the Japanese defeated Russia. This was the first time a non-white race had defeated a white race since the beginning of the colonialism. So it was a signal wake-up call to the Tsarists. So therefore, they decided to concentrate their efforts towards India. So there's an increased activity, if you read history of the Tsarist Russia, was increased activity from Russia towards India, which you touched upon in your paper. So the Afghan emir was under enormous pressure. So that he felt the need to find allies. So that was it was a game of geopolitics at that time.
So it was a civilizational kind of choice he made.
Yeah, it was.
Thank you so much. Very interesting insight.
Very interesting.
Yep. Definitely. Then a lot of questions asked are answered now regarding Calcutta and why that long going there. And yeah. Thank you. Definitely great to have brothers who can add these interesting details. Brother Bharat, you don't have any questions, I guess, so I can lower your hand.
Yes, please.
No, Brother Bharat has all the answers, David. He doesn't have to go.
Well, we for education reasons, we might ask things which are we might have answers for. So that's not a problem. Brother Joseph, floor is yours. Please unmute.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
I'm looking from a different angle. Really, did the British have any choice at all? Because here you have a ruler of an Islamic country who must have been getting feelers from the Ottomans and the other Islamic countries, and getting into his bad books would have resulted in the entire repositioning of the forces and stuff like that. Because as you said, it's a very strategically located country on the boundary between British India and the Ottoman Empire. Could it have been that it was just a test by him to check the sincerity of the British? Like, they must be telling him like, we are friends and stuff like that. But was it a test that he gave to them? Were they really willing to make me a friend? And he put it to them, and probably the British passed the test. Rather than anything else, you know, it's like, okay, you say that you're friends of mine, but if you're really my friend, make me a Freemason. Let me see if you can do that. You know, it's like, how far are you willing to go? Is it just talk or is it something more? That's all.
Again, see, we are just trying to read between the lines. It's very difficult to say anything. One is it's 110th, 13 years back. Whatever records we have is what we have. Reading between the lines can lead anybody anywhere, and you know, everybody can read it in with his own slant and with his own biases. But you know, I would think that the Emir was keen because he wanted his country to be modern. He didn't want his country to go back. I'm giving the same answer that I gave David. he didn't want his country to regress. I mean, 113 years back, this was a concern. Even today in Afghanistan, this is a concern. You know, history doesn't change, only the actors change. But I think that he definitely wanted his country to be modern. He had the welfare of his people in mind. And he knew he had to be allies with the British. And he probably had heard somewhere that, you know, if you are a Freemason, then you are amongst the movers and shakers of British Empire. So possibly, I mean, this is just again a guess.
No, where I'm coming from is that what I've read and heard is that a lot of the Maharajas and Nawabs, for them, it was a prestige matter to become a Freemason. It was like you become equal to the British elite of that time. And you have cases of the Maharaja of Nizam of Hyderabad and persons like that, you know, like persistently wanting to be a Freemason so that he could be on the same level.
Possible. I mean, very, very highly possible that he wanted to be on the level, at a higher level. Quite likely.
Okay, it's also an interesting take on it. Just testing to what extent you consider me not only ally, but now brother.
Brother.
Is that supposed to be the most sacred kind of community for elite, I think? And he said, can you get me there? Am I a member of the... So, yeah. Why not? That could have been one of the motivations, though it took a nice package with it, the connections, the civilizational. It doesn't contradict in motivation with other aspects, I guess, that he might have had. Question from the chat room by Rob Bond. Who were his influences? Do we have any data on that?
No. Afghanistan, countries were largely landlocked. Communications, telegram. I don't think even telephones were there in Afghanistan. Some newspapers, people going back and forth, letters. You know, this was what communication essentially was. But within that communication, he had heard that Freemasonry was something very desirable. So we don't know how he got it, how he influenced it, who came and told him this, but somewhere or the other, somebody has told him in that landlocked country that Freemasonry is something that you should try to become a Freemason. Good men are Masons, etc., etc. So how even the author says how he decided to become a Freemason and how he heard of Freemasonry, he doesn't know and he didn't reveal. But he just knew that he had heard that Freemasons are good people and, you know, you wanted to be a Freemason.
Okay, thank you. I'll have to interrupt the lecture for 1 second. Jonathan, could you kindly identify yourself by camera and microphone? We just want to see you. Jonathan? Jonathan? I would like to see you, if it's possible.
David, is Jonathan in trouble? Because you're sounding very scary.
No, but I think he's making some private comments which he shouldn't be doing. So I just want to know which Jonathan we are dealing with, because we never had any problem with bothering people in this room. Jonathan, I'll have to move you to the waiting room unless you identify yourself. Now, please. Okay. We don't have time for this. Sorry for participants who've been bothered, and thanks for reporting. Sorry for interrupting the lecture. Sometimes some discipline measures need to be taken so we can continue in harmony. Have you answered? Are you done? Sorry for interrupting you.
Yes, I think I have.
Any follow-up? Okay, it was from the chat. Furok Santoke, please, floor is yours. Unmute yourself.
Yes. Yeah, thank you, Brother Venkat, for a really illuminating talk. And regarding this interest of Afghanistan and other countries in Freemasonry, I think, as Brother Josen said, Freemasonry always held an allure, and people always wanted to join Freemasonry to be up there with them, kind of a thing. And QCC has a paper on the formation of the Grand Lodge of Iran, and even over there they mentioned that there were many royal blood personnel of Persia who were not directly admitted by UGLE, so they went to France to become Freemasons. So there are at least half a dozen royal blood from Persia who became Freemasons in France. And so in the Middle East, the allure of Freemasonry always was there. But maybe it was very difficult to become one, and they had to really strive hard to become one. So I would agree with Brother Josen that it could have been just the allure, and definitely it, for diplomatic reasons, it made much more sense for the emir to become a Freemason and to sort of assure himself of protection or a protectorate if push came to shove. That was my point.
Quite likely, Brother Farooq. Thank you for joining. You are very well aware of, you know, even the Scottish Constitution and the Indians wanting to become Freemasons. I mean, Kersaji Malnik, the rising star of Western India. I mean, that history is there, you know, at our own doorsteps in Bombay. So yes, Freemasonry was something that was aspirational in value. And the Britishers, the English Constitution at that time did try to keep it for the whites only, kind of thing. And we know the history of lodges, and you know how they over a period of time, you know, evolved into admitting, you know, natives, as we were called during those times. So yes, there was an aspirational value, and a lot of the Scottish, you know, history of Freemasonry in India is around that. And yes, definitely there was an aspirational value. Kersaji Manakji, for example, went to France and became a, you know, Mason, and then many others went to other constitutions which were more willing to admit them. And that kind of hoping to gain entry by backdoor approach did prevail at that point of time. And you're right, it had aspirational values.
Yes, and there were many of Persian royal blood who also became the same way in France.
Okay.
Thank you. We have a question from the chat. Matvinder is asking, after going back home, did he establish any lodges or not? And that was, I would complement that question with whether he continued actually his Masonic journey, and do we have any data him kind of developing himself in that regard?
I don't think any Freemasonry lodge was ever established in Afghanistan, to the best of my knowledge. Yes, there have been Freemasonry lodges active in Pakistan till, you know, we divided and Pakistan then banned Freemasonry. But there has been no evidence of any lodge in Pakistan, to the best of my knowledge, other than the US military lodges, which continue to function, which are US Masons, continue to work their rituals in, you know, military base camps. But other than that, I don't think the Amir ever practiced Freemasonry, or he went around trying to establish Freemasonry, because the story also says that the mullahs kind of took it upon themselves to challenge him, and he had a, you know, show off between him and the mullahs, and he told that, you know, he has become a Mason only for the good of the country, etc. So I don't think he could have in any way, you know, progressed himself as a Mason. Almost immediately after that, the World War I broke out. And after the World War I, within about 1 or 2 years after that, he was, you know, executed by his own son. So, I mean, where was the time?
Okay, thank you for the answer. Just Matvinder kind of commented that, to my knowledge, General Parvez Musharraf was a Mason.
I have no idea. That is news to me, and I have no idea.
Okay.
I mean, I'll try to find out, but I have no idea.
Okay, thank you. Karim, floor is yours. Hope you got to the office or you'll be talking from the car.
No, I just arrived, but I'm quite happy to be here. I would like to first thank Brother Venkatraman for this very interesting presentation. Thank you very much. And I would just like to take this opportunity to extend to all the participants. You are invited here in Egypt. Now you have brothers in Egypt. So if any time after the COVID-19 curfew that is controlling everyone, you are very welcome to come here. You have family here, and we're waiting for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Karim. Thank you. Simon Wills.
He's the secretary of the lodge. We are honored to have him. He's the secretary of the current lodge.
We are honored, but he needs to unmute himself.
Yes.
So we can see him and hear him.
How's that better?
No, now it works. Go ahead.
Apologies. First of all, thank you, very worshipful Brother Venkat, for the interesting presentation, much of which we're familiar with within the lodge. Indeed, we recount an abbreviated form of the story at our festive board after each meeting. And as part of that, we enjoy a loving cup, which is a big silver cup presented by the Amir a couple of years after he became a member. So that is still tradition within the lodge. There's no evidence that he ever did anything Masonic after he went back to Afghanistan, within the lodge records anyway. But I think, going back to some of the points that were raised earlier, I think there were a number of issues really to do with him becoming the Mason, as has already been stated. One is to prove the British faith in him as a friend, and to be able to continue the westernization of his country. I think those are the two main things. But why Concordia in particular, I think, is almost certainly to do with the fact that Lord Kitchener was a member. A couple of points just about the ceremony that took place. They didn't do the perambulations in the first and second degree. That was the only bits that they admitted. And the question that arose about the Quran, on which he took his obligation, that is still on display at the Museum of Freemasonry at Great Queen Street in London. Thank
Fantastic.
You.
I would like to have a copy of the telegram which you have shared with Brother Sri, or I will take it from Brother Sri and, you know, complete my archives of the talk.
I'll send it to you.
Thank
across.
You. One question was that the cup is also there. I've seen the cup being this. Any idea, I mean, could you throw any light on why was this lodge chosen in particular? Because that was something that Sri had asked. If we have some further information on that.
No, apart from the fact that Lord Kitchener was a member, I think he may have had the direct contacts.
Okay.
And it was, the membership consisted of very senior civil service and military officers.
Okay.
So prestige also, and the kind of environment where he was made member was kind of high enough for an emir of Afghanistan to kind of participate, I guess. And Bharat's point that it was in the capital also kind of contributes to that. Brother Geoff?
David?
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah, Simon, please.
Sorry, one further point. Most of the text that you're using from McMahon is contained in this document, which is an original of the story that was circulated amongst the membership when McMahon wrote the story. I don't think I can bring that there, whether you can actually see it now. The background's playing with it.
Yeah.
But I have this. This is the original one, and every new member of the lodge gets a copy of that.
Oh, wow, fantastic. So nice. Thank you so much for bringing all this to the meeting.
I also, if it's of interest to anybody, they can send me a message on Twitter.
Okay, I'll do that.
I've got lots of documentation that I can send, copies of the minute book, the members register, the original summons, the telegram, lots of bits and pieces. If anybody's interested, send me a message and I'll see what I can do.
Fantastic.
Thank you for that. Thank you for that.
My pleasure. And now I'm afraid I have to leave. So.
Sure. Thank you.
Honored to have you here. Thank you very much.
Very interesting. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Brother Bye. Simon. Geoff, floor is yours.
Thank you, David. Very worshipful Brother Venkat, thank you for a very interesting lecture and an insight into a unique part of Freemasonry in India. Really, just two points. I was wondering whether the Emir was ever educated outside of Afghanistan and whether that influenced his desire to join Masonry. And the second part really is, just doing some background skimming, I noticed that the British were subsidising his rule at the time in return for providing advice to his country, and whether or not that in itself was a motivation for him to take on to become a Freemason as a result of the people helping him being Freemasons also. Is there any kind of information on that regard?
Not really. But it was not unusual in those days for the kings to have, you know, coaches, mentors, governors from Great Britain who would teach them in the ways of the modern world. Yes. And it is quite likely that he was influenced by them. It is quite likely that they must have left an impression on him about Masonry, but I have no idea.
Yeah, it's just opinion.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you. And I really enjoyed that.
Thank you.
Thank you, David.
Thank you so much. I'll just check. There is no question. Shalom, Rabishvili, something in French. Saying thank you to the presenter and the WhatsApp. We don't have questions. Hello, brother. Would you please add to the... Okay, that's different. All right. Brother Rob, floor is yours.
David, again, the Grand Lodge of Georgia, thank you so, so much for everything that you do in organizing these lectures. And I've got to say that tonight's lecture and the last one, by Brother Barat, have been of the very, very highest standard, and I can only congratulate both brothers on the work that they've done, and thoroughly enthralled me, and has encouraged me to go and look this up even further. Fabulous guys, absolutely fabulous work, and I just keep on looking forward to all the future lectures that are coming up. So there really is no question. It was just a big, big thank you from Rob Beaumont here in the West Midlands in England. So thank you very, very much, guys. Thank you.
Thank you so much for great warm words, Rob. You're always welcome. Thank you so much for opportunity. Okay, there are a lot of thank you messages in public and private, which is, of course, what this presentation deserves. And if there are no other question, more or less we have covered then this very interesting topic, very interesting historical person, and that is a really interesting point to take into consideration, that those kind of decisions really were fate defining for the world, as in the context when the First World War was going on, that decision that the armies weren't moved from Arabia or Ottoman Empire to India just to keep up with the Afghanis or maybe Tsarist Russia kind of played its role in the final results of the war. So what we have, this is our history of the humankind, and thank you to a esteemed lecturer for bringing up this very interesting topic, and I look forward to two more presentations to discuss about. He was called Rajaji, right?
Rajagopalachari.
Yes, but in short, Rajaji, right? So we might have more insight about that historical person, the very first governor, right?
The first Indian Governor General of India.
Yeah, independence.
Bharat so, did refer to him in his own talk also.
yeah, he mentioned, and okay, I just want to thank you so much. And we're done with today's very interesting topic. Thank you so much, brother. And just to remind you, we're on Wednesday, we are expecting Brother Bob to talk about most probably we just need his confirmation regarding the Royal Order of Scotland. This is a long expected topic. And hopefully that will be topic, and I'll confirm you that tomorrow. Meanwhile, I would remind everyone that these lectures are public, recorded, and you can definitely go back to all the lectures which have been held since April, early April, and. Actually, I've been asked several times, so I'll share it again. The link right here, so you can subscribe and get all the details every time we upload something new. Maybe final words you want to reference to any work of yours, Brother Venka, maybe present your lodge, whatever. I mean, the final wrapping up words from you. And then I'll stop the recording of the official part of the lecture and we move after lecture discussion of the topics.
Nothing really. This paper came to me about 20 years back. And I was a young mason at that time. I was about maybe 5-7 years into masonry and I'd just become a master and somebody came and gave me this paper and said, hey, you must read this. And this paper I found very fascinating. And I can say that this paper kind of told me at that point of time, you know, because once you become the Vashul master and you become a past master, in a typical lodge, you're wondering what next. And that is when you are at risk of, you know, leaving masonry. We all know that from our own lodges, that when the guy doesn't have anything better to do, then he wonders, now, why should he keep coming to the lodge anymore? And holding past masters is as difficult as holding initiates, you know, for those who run the lodge and try to take an interest in the lodge. So this paper, for me, proved to me the beneficial effects of continuing in Freemasonry. And you know, it was a very interesting paper. And I'm just hoping that, you know, by the story being retold many times, and there are many such stories in Freemasonry to be retold. We keep the original charm, original purpose, original value system of Freemasonry continued from generation to generation. And that is what this story did for me. That is why I took it upon myself to research this story a little bit more, bring it in current context, make it more meaningful, etc. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you again. Today is 29th of June, 2020, and this concludes our official part of the lecture.